हेलो हेलो। हाँ चालू झाली सर। टेक्निकल ग्लिच आला होता मला वाटतं। आमच्या इथे PMT पैकी दोन चालू आहे, परभणी इलाक्याचे चालू आहे। चुकून चुकून हे केलं वाटतं त्यांनी। सोर्स कंट्रोल कोणाकडे आहे? ओके मी चेक करतो। आहे सर, सगळं ऑन आहे, काही टेन्शन नाही। ओके होस्ट कुणाकडे आहे? अलेम्बिक
सर मी तर कोस्ट आहे
नाही, तुम्हीच बोलताय। कोण बोलताय?
सर लाटकर बोलतोय। सर लाटकर
मला होस्ट बनवा, राईट क्लिक करून।
सर मी होस्ट नाही। अच्छा मी होस्ट करतो सर तुम्हाला।
डॉक्टर आता बाकी ऍप मध्ये जाऊ नका प्लीज। थँक यू। रफीक भाई? हाँ घर पे है सर, मैं बोलता हूँ। मैडम
Thank you. So good evening, all the delegates and beloved participant. Now this is the fourth day of this online international training program on advanced reproductive technologies for augmentation of fertility in dairy animals. And today there will be three presentations by the different eminent speakers. And the presentation first, now within few minutes we are listen the experiences and the recent advances on the one of the important topic, that is the current scenario and prospects of embryo transfer technology in cows, which will be delivered by Dr. Sanjeev Chauhan sir. He is presently working as a director, international IVF system Trans-OVA Genetics in USA. Then second presentation is on reproductive health management and practices to improve the fertility of the animals, which is a very much important presentation from field point of view. And the speaker is the Dr. K. Murguvel, Professor, Department of Gynecology and Obstetrics, Rajiv Gandhi Institute of Veterinary Education Research, Puducherry, India. And third most important presentation on the effective storage and handling of the bovine frozen semen, which will be delivered by Dr. Jayan Khadse sir, Research Director, Bharti Agro Industries Foundation, Oradi Kanchan, Pune, Maharashtra. So today all the three important lectures are there, and I will go directly with the first presentation of Dr. Chauhan sir. And I request Head of Department Dr. Paushi sir to introduce our today's eminent speaker. Dr. Paushi sir, please.
Good evening, all important delegates and participants. Today we are having very eminent scientist presentation, Dr. Sanjeev Chauhan. He is the director of International IVF System, Trans-OVA Genetics and USA. Dr. Chauhan has completed his BSc from Mumbai Veterinary College and MBSc from Bombay Veterinary College. After immediately he joined the USA for the work of the embryo transfer and IVF system. He is very passionate work for the embryo transfer technology. He has also completed his PhD from the University of Connecticut in 2005. He is having 35 years of experience mainly for the cattle reproduction and 25 years of experience of embryo transfer and ovum pickup and IVF system. For the past 20 years working in the USA, established 4 IVF laboratory at Brazil and India, trained more than 50 embryologists and established IVF embryo production center. Presently responsible for establishing bovine IVF and expanding ATT technology in India and other countries. He is very well known for his work related to the production of various important calf from the IVF technology. He is giving his technology to the India also, and presently work with the Trans-OVA Genetics and USA. So I have requested Dr. Sanjeev Chauhan sir. He will start his lecture immediately. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
So on behalf of the organizing committee, on behalf of myself, sir, I am very much delighted and thankful to give a very excellent and eye-opening presentation on this very hot topic of this current scenario of embryo transfer technology in Indian scenario. And a really practical aspect of this biotechnology and how it can be very effectively utilized in coming decade for the animal improvement. It has been very well illustrated, sir. I feel I am very lucky to be here on this forum, and it has been cleared lot many doubt about this use of these technologies in coming period of time. So on behalf of the university as well as the institute, I am very much thankful, sir, for giving me your valuable time and sharing your last 20, 30 years experience in this biotechnology. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
Participant, after hearing a very useful and effective presentation, the second lecture is on the topic of reproductive health management and practices to improve the fertility of animals, which will be delivered by Dr. K. Murugavel. Murugavel sir is working as a professor, Department of Veterinary Gynecology and Obstetrics at Rajiv Gandhi Institute of Veterinary Education and Research, Puducherry in India. And to introduce this eminent speaker, I request Dr. H. G. Deshmukh, co-coordinator of this training, to introduce Dr. Murugavel, sir. Dr. Deshmukh, sir, please.
Thank you, sir. Good evening, all. Our next eminent speaker is Dr. K. Murugavel, sir. He is working as professor of Department of Veterinary Gynecology and Obstetrics, Rajiv Gandhi Institute of Veterinary Education and Research, Puducherry, India. Sir did his bachelor's degree from Madras Veterinary College, Tanuvas, Chennai, and MVC in ARGO from Madras Veterinary College, Chennai. Sir has did his PhD degree from the Faculty of Veterinary Science, Barcelona, Spain, in the year 2003. Sir, having a lot of experience and academic recognition in this field, near about 26 years of teaching, research, and extension he is having, and he is having near about 58 papers on his credit, out of which 10 is from international journals and near about 48 from national journals. He has also delivered lead papers in the conferences. Near about 3 lead papers he has delivered. He has guided 2 MVC students as a major advisor. Also, Murugavel sir handled different projects from the different funding agencies, like scientific breeding management of dairy cows for economic empowerment and social well-being of the rural woman by Department of Science and Technology, Government of Puducherry. He has handled another project entitled National Project for Cattle and Buffalo Breeding, Ministry of Agriculture, Government of India. He, sir, is also having several awards on his credit. Best Research Thesis, PhD Thesis for the year 2000-2003 by the Autonomous University of Barcelona, Spain. Junior Research Merit Fellowship in the year 1991 by the ICR. He has having gold medal for recognition of the performance in MVSC by ISSA. Best Research Paper Presentation Award in the scientific session in the International Symposium in 2009. May I request now Dr. Murugavel sir, please deliver his lecture to our participants. Thank you, sir.
Good evening to our organizers. Can you able to hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Okay. Thank you for giving an introduction about me. Good evening to all the organizers and participants. So here they have given me a small topic on uterine health management. Shall I start my slide? Can you see the slide?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So my topic is reproductive health management and practices to improve fertility. Even though they are given the reproductive health management, I am going to concentrate on uterine health specifically. That is an important topic when compared to other things. So I decided to give more importance to uterine health management. So you know that the profitability of the dairy farming depends upon reproductive efficiency. And if you want to get maximized reproductive efficiency, we have to maintain optimum body condition. That is, body condition score should be the minimum. And the reproductive health management practices should be there in order to ensure the interval from calving to conception should be shorter and the rate of conception should be high, and resulting in short calving intervals, yielding more lactation and calves per lifetime of each breeding cow. Hence, maintaining optimum reproductive health of the animal holds the foremost importance in animal husbandry practices. For good reproductive efficiency, the cow has to have functional ovaries. The both ovaries should be functional, and it should display estrous behavior normally, and it should mate and conceive, sustain the embryo through the gestation calve, and resume estrous cyclicity and restore uterine function after calving. So this last line is important, that is, to resume estrous cyclicity and restore uterine function after calving, that is during the postpartum period. That plays a major role in controlling the reproduction in cattle. However, the reproductive disorders are found to be a major reason for decreased reproductive efficiency in cattle. That I think everyone knows. The major reproductive disorders that have a direct effect on reproductive performance of dairy cows are abortion, dystocia, retained fetal membrane, uterine diseases, genital prolapse, anisthesis, and repeat breeding. The postpartum period, that's after calving, is the most susceptible phase to the most of the problems that coincide with the peak milk yield, uterine involution, resumption of ovarian activity, conception, and greater risk for the infection. So this postpartum period is very much important in animal husbandry practice. Actually, it's the most susceptible phase. Actually, in India, no one bothers about this one. Just they leave it as such. They'll be waiting for the animal to come to the estrus. Even sometimes we used to see that the owner brings the animal after 6 months after calving, telling that only today now the animal is showing teeth. Because of that, we are slowly delaying the process. Because of that, we are having a lot of problems. All these things is because of that the postpartum period, where the infection might have entered inside, created an issue, or the animal is not resuming ovarian activity. We have to find out what is the reason. And unfortunately, during that period only, the animal is going to be in a peak milk yield. That's why the owners are also not concentrating during that period. But in other European countries, if you see, the first importance will be given during postpartum period. I myself was seeing immediately after calving till the animal going to conceive, that is a period where they are going to give it importance. Later, I'll discuss other things. Okay. Naturally, normally, in healthy animal, the cervix is open following parturition and lochia is passed until 15 to 20 days postpartum. And during involution, lochia changes from reddish brown color to more viscous yellow white discharge. That will slowly it will be changing, and it will be all right by 15 to 20 days. But still, the complete involution based on cytological test proves to be 40 to 50 days postpartum. And if you see the uterine on diameter, it will come around 3 to 4 centimeter by 25 to 30 day postpartum, and cervical diameter will be less than 5 mm by 40 days postpartum. So that is the important thing. The animal has to come back to the normal thing, and the complete involution based on the cytological picture, it should be around 40 to 50 days postpartum in case of dairy cattle. In case of buffalo, it will be still more earlier. And majority of the postpartum uterine diseases begins with bacterial contamination in the uterine lumen. But all the animals, postpartum uterus of all the animals will be always having some bacteria. It's a more contaminated place when during after parturition. But still, mostly it will not end up in clinical diseases. Because for establishment of the clinical diseases, immune response to the animals should reduce, and also the number of bacteria or the load or challenge should be increased. Based on that only, establishment of uterine diseases will take place. The number of pathogenic organisms in the uterus of the postpartum cow may be great enough to hem the uterine defense mechanism and causing uterine diseases. So after parturition, the uterus always will be having bacterial contamination. When the animal is going to come down with the immune response, and if the load of bacteria is more, then only this will end up in infection. And uterine pathology is negatively affect reproduction. That everyone knows. Uterine pathology mainly plays a role in reproduction, causing direct endometrial damage. That is, it will be damaging the endometrium, number one. Number two, it will be producing a toxin. So bacterial toxin are known to have produced numerous effect on reproduction. That's one of the biggest problems we'll be facing. So it used to affect the estradiol, progesterone secretion, and alter follicular growth and the normal development of the CL, and interferes with LH production and cause ovulation failure, increase PGE2 secretion and prolong the lifespan of the CL. And it also induces early embryonic death or early embryonic mortality. Postpartum uterine diseases are considered to be economical loss to the dairy enterprise. So why it is going to be a loss to the dairy enterprise? Because of postpartum diseases, there will be slower uterine involution, reduced reproduction rate, prolonged intercalving period, negative effect on fertility, increased cost of medication, drop in milk production, reduced crop, and increased culling rate. There will be more culling because of infertility problem. And what are the postpartum uterine diseases? Puerperal metritis, clinical metritis, pyometra, endometritis. In endometritis, we are having two types of endometritis. That is, one is clinical endometritis, another one is subclinical endometritis. And nowadays, people started using the word cytological endometritis for reference, subclinical endometritis. Previously, in Roberts and all, they used to give a lot of explanation that is septic metritis, other, etc. But now, in 2006, the whole theory generally has accepted a definition given by Sheldon et al. According to Sheldon, it is puerperal metritis with abnormally increased enlarged uterus with fetid, watery, red, brownish uterine discharge associated with signs of systemic illness. That is, it will be having systemic illness like fever, toxemia, dullness, milk yield reduced, all these things will be there. And fever will be more than 39.5 degrees centigrade. And everything happens within 21 days postpartum. Then we will be calling this puerperal metritis. That is, fetid odor, enlarged uterus with signs of systemic illness within 21 days postpartum. In case of clinical metritis, there won't be any systemic illness. There won't be fever or animal is not going to show any signs of toxemia, etc. But still, it will be having an abnormally enlarged uterus with a purulent uterine discharge. You see the difference, purulent uterine discharge. In puerperal metritis, it's a reddish brown or fetid discharge, undetectable in the uterus, and it is also within 21 days. So these two things are main metritis problem. It's a main classification done for metritis. Then there's also another condition, pyometra, that everyone knows that it's a purulent material present in the uterine lumen with the presence of corpus luteum with a closed cervix. That's another thing. Then another important thing is clinical endometritis. Clinical endometritis is presence of purulent, that is more than 50% pus, or mucopurulent, approximately 50% pus and 50% mucus together. Uterine exudate in the vagina for 21 days or more postpartum, that's after 21 days, and no systemic illness. This is clinical endometritis. So clinical endometritis, there will be purulent discharge from the vaginal passage after 21 days postpartum with no clinical signs. Sorry, with no systemic signs of illness. The significant factors were the presence of purulent vaginal discharge with the cervical diameter 7.5 centimeters and 21 days or more postpartum, or after 26 days postpartum with the presence of mucopurulent material from the vagina. So it may be a purulent discharge during after 21 days or after 26 days, maybe mucopurulent discharge with no systemic illness. That's more important. And next is very important thing, subclinical endometritis. In case of subclinical endometritis, the inflammation of the endometrium in the absence of any signs of clinical endometritis. That is, there won't be any purulent vaginal discharge, and it is always associated with delayed uterine involution. There won't be any discharge, purulent discharge, but still the animal will be having delayed uterine involution. Nowadays, the people have started referring it as cytological endometritis. If you see that cytology of the endometrium during this period, if you are going to take the sample around 21 to 33 days postpartum, if the neutrophil count is more than 18% in the uterine cytology, then the animal, we can say it is a case of subclinical endometritis. And if you are going to take that sample around 34 to 47 days, and if the neutrophil count is more than 10%, then also we have to say it is a case of subclinical endometritis. The incidence of subclinical endometritis varies from 7 to 53%. The great variation is due to the postpartum period when the diagnosis is made. That is, if you are going to do it in very early stage, there will be increased number of subclinical endometritis. If you are going to do later in the postpartum period, it will be having less. And another thing is the cutoff threshold level of polymorphonuclear cells. The one what we were discussing, neutrophils. Previously, I was telling you, it is around 18, more than 18 or more than 10%. So in some people used to have more than 20, some people used to have more than 5 itself is endometric like this. So there is a difference of opinion. So that also plays a role. And then method of diagnosis, how we have diagnosed that one, that also plays a major role. We are having different type of diagnosis that we'll be discussing now in detail. So directly come to diagnosis of subclinical endometritis. Why I'm giving more importance to subclinical endometritis? That is, if the animal is going to be having metritis or clinical endometritis, you can able to see the lesions or clinical signs or any systemic illness, etc. So immediately you can go for a treatment, you can treat that animal, then you can go for insemination. Whereas in case of subclinical endometritis, the animal is not going to see any systemic illness, and the animal is not going to show any purulent or mucopurulent discharge. The discharge will be clear. So we will be thinking that animal is looking normal. So we will be keep on inseminating the animal, thinking that everything is good. And even sometimes we'll be clustering in this repeat breeder. But actually, the animal may be having subclinical endometritis, which rarely remain undiagnosed. So it's very difficult to diagnose in subclinical endometritis without doing any test. Whereas in case of clinical metritis, endometritis rarely remain undiagnosed. Yes, somehow we can able to find out the discharge from the vaginal passage. Immediately we can go for treatment. So that is the important thing. And it is going to have effect on reproduction, even though it is not showing any clinical sign, but still it is going to have more effect on reproduction. That is, especially the conception rate will be delayed. Delayed involution of the uterus, both are noticed in case of subclinical endometritis. But still, we will not be treating that animal because it is not going to show any clinical sign. That's why it is a hidden problem for cattle owners. So the first people started doing white sight test. That's a very common test people used to do. In, I think most of your colleges also people will be doing this white sight test. Actually, this white sight test was first done for diagnosing the mastitis. Now people started doing it for cervical mucus also. The cervical mucus is collected aseptically from the suspected animal with the help of a sheath and syringe, that AA sheath and syringe. And we will be taking the equal amount of 5% sodium hydroxide, and we have to boil it. If the color turns yellow, then it's a positive for subclinical endometritis. The color also varies. It will be white, light yellow, dark yellow, like that. It's depending upon the intensity of the subclinical endometritis. Actually, it is based on the correlation with the number of leukocytes present in the mucus and the intensity of the yellow color. That's what, if there is more leukocyte, there will be more intensity of the yellow color will be seen. And white sight test seems to be having a significant positive correlation with bacterial load in cervical mucus as well as uterine flushing. And you can see, yes, the example taken from a textbook only. You can see the first thing, so it is, in this case, there is no change of color. So in this condition, you can say it's not having any subclinical endometritis. And slowly you can say, in the other case, light yellow color, then little lighter, then dark yellow. So you can see all these three things are suffering from endometritis, except the first one. And then another test is endometrial biopsy. It's another method. Endometrial biopsy is collecting the sample from the caudal one-third portion of the uterine horn with the help of uterine biopsy catheter. If you do histological section and see, then you can able to see disruption of surface epithelium, leukocyte infiltration, and varying degree of glandular degeneration. But still it is having a lot of drawbacks. That is, it is more time consuming. That is, after collecting the sample, we have to go for processing, sectioning, strain, or it's having a long process and expensive. And it is invasive because we are going to remove a tissue out of endometrium. And this will end up in problem in fertility, future fertility, because we are going to harm the endometrium by taking a pinch of tissue from that one. That also going to create issue later. And because of this delayed process of preparing all this one, this test is not useful for spot planning of therapeutic regimen. That is, if you are able to identify immediately, we can go for treatment. Here it is not possible. Then this is one type of uterine biopsy forceps, Jackson. It is commonly used in Kerala. So with this help of thing from outside, they will manipulate and they'll take a small pinch of uterine tissue, endometrial tissue, and then they'll go for processing. And by that way, they are going to damage the endometrium. It may also affect the future fertility. Then another one is leukocyte esterase calorimeter strip. So it is just like a pH strip. We'll be having the strip, and it is a cow side diagnostic method for diagnosis of subclinical endometritis. And leukocyte esterase is a type of enzyme produced by neutrophils. And this LES is being used as an indirect method to detect inflammation. And results can be obtained by LAs are positively correlated with the endometrial cytology test. That is, endometrial cytology test, endometrial cytology gives a proper information regarding the endometrium that we'll be discussing later. So this result is having a positive correlation with this endometrial cytology result. So in this test, the uterine contents are collected by aspiration technique and were used for this leukocyte esterase strip test. The samples are smeared in the test strips with a multi-strip 10X. That's a reagent strip available in the market. And that we have to wait for 2 minutes. Then we have to see that color change. Based on the color change, we can able to see whether it is going to have subclinical endometritis or not. So if you see this one esterase, it will be giving a violet azure dye color. Now I'll be showing them. So here you can able to see leukocyte esterase strip test color. So you can here in the first slide, you can able to see that the green color and purple change. That shows that the animal is going to have endometritis, subclinical endometritis. There is no change in color, then you can say that the animal is not having endometritis. The next one is rectal palpation, which is very easy. That can be done by every veterinarian during examination of them. But still, it may be useful for diagnosis of some other uterine conditions, but not for subclinical endometritis. It is really impossible to identify subclinical endometritis by doing rectal palpation. Even in case of normal metritis, it is possible, whereas in case of subclinical endometritis, it's very difficult. And next one is transrectal ultrasonography. So nowadays people started using ultrasonography for diagnosis of many uterine conditions as well as ovarian diseases like cystic ovary, etc. But here also, it's very difficult to do diagnosis for subclinical endometritis problem. Just they'll go for 2 things. One is intrauterine fluid content that they can be able to identify with ultrasound. Then number 2 is uterine diameter. This is based on uterine diameter, intrauterine fluid content, and also we can see the change in the endometrial ecotexture. echotecture, endometrial echotecture, that is based on that brightness of the tissue. That echotecture changes because of the cell density present in the endometrium. Based on this, we can able to identify to some extent the endometrial condition in the animal. But it is always difficult because during even in a normal estrus or early postpartum period, the animal may be having fluid in the uterine uterus as well as the uterine wall may be, uterine mucosa may be thick. So we cannot be able to rule out other normal things also by doing transrectal ultrasonography. So most of the studies assume that ultrasonography is not a sensitive test when compared to endometrial cytology for subclinical endometriosis diagnosis. Then people started using Doppler ultrasonography. This is mostly based on how much of blood supply is taking place to the endometrial arteries. So people have started studying the endometrial blood flow in case of normal and endometriosis cases. Slowly they are going developing some idea how it can be done, or I able to use this one to identify this problem. Still they could not able to identify in cases of clinical endometriosis. It's only still an unexplored tool. Maybe in later days they may able to come up with some idea how we can able to identify endometriosis with the Doppler ultrasonography. Then endometrial cytology. This is the best one when compared to all the tests. So in case of endometrial cytology, it's accepted as a practice to evaluate the uterine health of the animal. So the uterine health of the animal can be assessed by just doing endometrial cytology. That is presence of polymorphonuclear cells in relation to endometrial cells that we have to record. How much percentage of PMN cells when compared to total number of cells in the endometrial cytology. Based on that, we can be able to identify the problem in the animal. So everyone will be having some threshold. Just they'll fix up to 18%, this is good. More than 18%, it is going to have endometriosis. Like that, they have their own thing. And based on that, they will be identifying the animal in endometriosis. So nowadays, people started going for endometrial cytology. That's the best test to evaluate the uterine health of a cow. So endometrial cytology, we require a sample. Endometrial cytology, we require a sample that has to be collected from the uterus. And we are having different methods, that is direct guarded swab method, cytotape method, uterine lavage method. In that uterine lavage, we are once again having a low volume of uterine lavage, that is low volume of fluid is used for that purpose. Aspiration technique, by aspiration we will be doing this one. Then the last is the cytobrush technique. That's a very excellent technique that has been used regularly in foreign countries. Now people started using in India also. So in case of a guarded swab or direct swab method, just a cotton swab like a earbud, the same type of thing will be fixed with a solid stainless steel rod. And this will be having a double guarded. It will be having double guard. Still, it is going to enter the uterus. It will be guarded by two sheets like thing. And after reaching the uterus, then we have to enter into the uterus like rectovagin technique of artificial insemination. Vagina, vulva, sorry, vulva, vagina, cervix, then we have to enter into the uterus. Then after reaching the uterus, uterine body, the swab is extended out and gently we have to roll for approximately 15 seconds. Then the swab is once again retracted into the sheet, then the rod is taken out. Then after bringing the rod out, we have to roll over this glass slide to make a smear and then we have to stain. So here you can see. So this is a bud having two guard, first one and then second. And after that, this will be coming out. Till it is entering the uterus, it will be covered like this. After entering the uterus, first sheath will be coming out, then second guard, then third, this swab will be coming out. Then we have to make a swab smear over the endometrium. Then once again, we have to bring back to this inside. Then this should be brought out. That way we can do it. Then next one is cytotape method. That cytotape is nothing but instead of this one cotton swab, just we'll be having a tape. It's nothing but 1.5 centimeter piece, that paper tape, by micro tape available. No, the tape will be rotated over the AA gun, and the same type of thing is used for doing the same. Like that, once again, it will be having a closed sheet, double sheet also it will be there. Then you have to enter into the uterus, roll twice in the dorsal wall of the uterine body. And at the time, you will be getting mild, gentle pressure by the index finger through the rectum. Then the tape is taken out. The same way what we are doing for the swab, it will be done in case of cytotape method. Only thing, instead of swab, this would be having a tape. That's all. And next one is aspiration method, where 2 to 3 ml of fluid is aspirated from the uterine lumen using a sterile uterine catheter connected to a 20 ml disposable syringe and transferred in the sterile tube. So here once again, like a uterine catheter is passed into the uterus with just like a gun, and we can try to pull around 2 to 3 ml of the fluid with the help of a syringe attached to the other end. Then this sample should be taken to the lab and stored at 4 degrees centigrade. And then we have to go for his smearing of the slide and examine under microscope for percentage of polymorphonuclear cells. And next one is lavage technique. In case of lavage technique, the fluid will be infused inside. Around 60 ml of normal saline is infused into the uterine body. Then we have to massage it. Then we have to recover the fluid by aspiration. It's just like embryo transfer, allowing the fluid inside, taking back the fluid along with the cells present in the endometrium. So by the end, within 2 hours, it should be brought to the lab, centrifuged at 1000 RPM for 15 minutes. Then we have to discard the supernatant fluid. Then we have to take a smear out of the sediment. A small drop of the sediment is taken and sticked out of the clean microscope slide and add right. Then we have to strain and then examine under oil immersion for presence of PMN cells. The same technique can be used by using a small volume. Instead of 60 ml, people started using 20 ml. That we call low volume lavage technique. Other things are almost same. The only thing is the volume of sodium chloride solution, that is normal saline used for flushing, is 20 ml. But here it will be a little difficult to collect all the fluid when compared to the other one. And at least 2 ml should be collected. Then only we can go for testing this PMN cells. And once again, it will be centrifuged and the supernatant fluid will expelled out, excluded, and the pellet should be taken for smearing for the glass slide. Then we have to go for straining and examination under microscope. And this is more important, cytotrace technique. So, has been described as the best technique for obtaining uterine cytology in cows due to its reliability and lack of cell distortion. So it has been told that it's the best technique when compared to other technique for collecting the sample. But still it is having one drawback that we will be discussing later. And Kasim Manikam has done a lot of work in the USA. He's my classmate, that's why I used to refer him regularly. So we were studying together our BBC days. And he has done a lot of work on cytobrush. And this is the technique nowadays people started following in India. So the cytobrush is nowadays available for animal cattle. So this is a cytobrush available for cattle in foreign countries. This is by Minitube. You can see the cytobrush covered by a sheet. So just the brush will come out. Then we have to take inside after putting the thing inside. That's how we have to use this one. And the instrument is sent it through the cervix to the uterine horn. Then the sheath is retracted back. That is, this is the sheath, this one. This should be taken back so that this will be exposed to the endometrium. Right? So with the help of the cytobrush, we have to make one clockwise direction rotation in the uterine horn. It's 45 to 90 degree rotation is sufficient to take a good sample in the uterus. So they recommend to go for 45 degree or maximum 90 degree rotation in the clockwise direction. That is sufficient to take sufficient tissue. So this will be, after taking this one, it will be taken back once again inside the sheath, and then it will be taken out. And the slide should be prepared by rolling over the rolling the site effects over the clean Microsoft slide, and then we had to go for fixing our straining, etc. Then followed by that, we had study. A minimum of 100 people are there, but nowadays people are going a minimum of 200 cells should be studied to find the percentage of neutral, that is percentage of polymorph nuclear cells. So this cell, this type, you can see this one, the this portion, the extremity, the flesh is seen outside and it is close with the sheep. After going inside, it will be taken out, then we'll be taking a rotation, then once again to take it inside. The pressure will take back some tissues from the intermediate. So this is more useful in European countries. Regularly we will be having a pure HF animals, and regularly they will be doing this one without any problem, because you know the cervix, everything is big and it is easy to do in European animal when compared to Indian animal. But in case of Indian animal, this cannot pass inside the cervix. That's the biggest problem we are facing. So you see, this is the tip of the site of breast prepared for animal, but this is a gun. You see the diameter between these two. It's almost 2 or 3 times bigger than this one. So this cannot enter the Indian cattle cervix when compared to this one. Even crossbred animals also, it is not possible when compared to the European pure HF animals. So for our animal, we are having our own limitations. So not able to use this site of brush for animal, Indian animal. So we started modifying that one. So we used to purchase this one, cervical cytology brush, that is used for human site. Human side, they'll be using cervical cytology brush that's costing around 55 rupees like that. So that this is the brush, same site of brush type of thing. So this is the we used to purchase from the market, and just with the scale I have shown so that you can able to see the length. And here you can see the site of brush. It will be same the site of brush what we have seen in actual cattle. Then we have made that A gun, the same A gun, we have modified it by making a threads inside so that we can fix this one into the, so we'll be, so here you can see this one, a long thing, so they'll be using for human side. So we will cut this one to this level, off the level, then we may see that it is placed. So now we have cut that one, then we can make a sharp edge in the, and then we'll be threading inside this one. This after threading this one, it will be looking like this. So this is a normal A gun modified with the cytobrush brush. So over, so now it is looking like this. Now we'll be taking the A sheet, what we are doing in the A ward. No, the same sheet is taken. The tip of the sheet, we'll be cutting that tip because it will be having a narrow end. So that we'll be cutting that one. And then we will be putting over this one. So it will be looking like this. Okay. So it will be looking like this direction. This way we will be sending this one inside the uterus, and we will be reaching the body of the uterus. Then after reaching the body of the uterus, we will be dragging this one back. The sheath will be taken back. So the now we can be able to see the brush is exposed out. So rotation in the endometry, just half rotation or quarter rotation is sufficient in the clockwise, and but nowadays people started using the one direction clockwise. So after making this one, once again the brush should be taken inside like this, the sheath, and then it should be brought out of the vaginal passage. So then after bringing out, we have to make a smear in the slide by rolling this one. We have to just roll over the slide. If you make that one, it will come out nicely. Then with that slide, we have to go for staining. So different, all type of staining can be tried. Actually, modified GIMSA, right GIMSA strain, Leishman GIMSA strain, quick strain, any type of strain can be used. But foreign countries, I've seen people always using right GIMSA or quick strain. In our lab, in our Pondicherry lab, we have used Leishman GIMSA strain, and it is coming out nicely. And we used to see under 400x magnification to differentiate the cells, that is endometrial cells, PMN cells and squamous cells, and we will count a minimum of 200 cells. And the cells will be looking like this. So we are having, I have shown you 4 samples. This is all I have taken up from other side. So in A, you can see that is the large arrows are representing endometrial cells, and the small arrows are representing polymorphous nuclear cells, this one. So you can see in the first slide, A, there is no PMN cells, there is 0%. And in case of B, you can see it's having around 15% of cells. And in C, you can able to see some more cells. So almost 25% of total cells is polymorphous nuclear cells. And in the D, you can see almost 50%. You can see more of this cell as equal number when compared to this one. So almost 50% of polymorphous. That way you can able to identify the problem. Later I'll be showing the different. So now I can able to show you four type of things. 1, 2, 3, 4 with different percentages of polymorphous nuclear cells. Now, different authors are given different values and different methods. That is, whether it's a Lavage method or a Cytobrush method, different people are given different thresholds level, up to which level we can allow the animal normally, otherwise we have to go for treatment. So it varies in different studies. And so the cutoff PMNL value reported by different authors seems to be varying from 4 to 25%, depending upon the postpartum period at which the diagnosis has been done and different the method they have used. So there's still people not able to identify what is the best one. So at that stage, we'll come to the next one. In general, most of the people are accepting that 15 to 18%, more than 15 to 18%, if the animal is going to have this polymorphous nuclear cells, then we can say it is endometritis if it is taken around 21 to 30 days. And if the value is 4 to 10%, more than 4 to 10%, in later stage also, it is comes under subclinical endometritis. Finally, Kasi Manik, once again, the same person. In 2004, he has used ROC analysis, receiver operating characteristics, to identify to how much percentage of PMNL cells will affect fertility significantly. And based on that, he has concluded that if the percentage of PMNL cells is more than 18%, if the sample is taken around 20 to 33 days postpartum, or if it is more than 10% when the sample is taken around 34 to 47 days postpartum, then the animal comes under endometritis and it will be having problem with the fertility. So that he has finally concluded. Now people started using this as a threshold level. But still, when you're going to take this one percentage, it used to vary depending upon that postpartum period. Here itself we can see during first weeks, third to fourth week, it's around 18%, later it is reducing. So it keep on varying. Now people started doing it only after first month. The first month, even a healthy animal may have higher percentage of PMNL cells. That's because of different findings they could able to say. You know, nowadays, even first postpartum period is having high PMNL cells. So people now asking to do this test after 1 month of postpartum to have an accurate diagnosis. The Cytobrush technique is consistent, reliable method and can provide sufficient uterine cells. With that brush, it is sufficient uterine cells can be obtained to perform both cytology test as well as gene expression analysis. Nowadays, people started doing gene expression analysis. Probably Kumaresan might have told regarding this one. So he is doing a lot of work on gene expression analysis in his NDRA lab, Bangalore. So for both, it can be done with a single test. And this test is non-invasive, even though we are going inside and taking, but still it is not going to affect the endometrium. And the sample obtained using a Cytobrush are representative of endometrial cells, which are directly involved in uterine immune defense mechanism. So that's why they always say it's reliable. Plus another one, that the cells we are going to get is there is no distortion of the cell. So it's easy to study under microscope when compared to the other test. When we are going to see uterine lavage method compared to Cytobrush, the lavage method takes more time for collecting the sample. Another one is the failure to get back that fluid. Almost 17% of the animals we are not able to get back the fluid what we have sent inside for uterine lavage. And increased distortion of the cell that is seen in this lavage method that is not seen in cytobrush technique. It may cause irritation to the endometrium because of increased fluid. And when you are going to see cotton swab method, it's also going to produce more distortion, so it will be difficult to study under microscope when compared to cytobrush technique. But still, even though it is having all the advantages, it is having one small advantage. That is, in case of cytobrush, we are going to collect the sample from a specific area of the endometrium where we are going to actually roll that one in the endometrium. Whereas in case of uterine lavage, with the help of fluid, it is almost going to the whole uterine surface and coming back. So it can take the cells from all the uterine area when compared to the cytobrush where we are going to take only in a specific endometrium area. Otherwise, this is the best test that can be performed very easily in the lab or in the colleges without any problem. Only thing, we have to modify that cytobrush according to our Indian condition. That's the thing we have to see. So the diagnosis is very important in endometritis, subclinical endometritis. Then regarding treatment of endometritis, there's a basic thing what we should do for treatment. One is we have to eliminate the bacteria from the uterus. That is number one. Number two, without inhibiting the normal uterine defense mechanism, we should not inhibit the uterine normal uterine defense mechanism. That's another thing. And number three, reducing the chances of residue of milk and meat for human milk. So the residue of the antibiotic what we are using should not be immediately it should not be more than the normal level in the blood, the milk or meat. That's the other thing. In India, we are using the milk, but other countries, they will be discarding the milk. That's a big thing. They'll be wasting so many liters of milk when they're going to treat the animal with antibiotics. So the treatment major classification, we can say antibiotics, sulfonamides, antiseptics, hormones. These are the things commonly used for treatment. So antibiotic, they'll be using different type of antibiotic from tetracycline, ampicillin, amoxicillin, cefotrioxin, all type of drugs have been used. And antiseptic, now very common antiseptic nowadays people are using is Lugol-Cyidine. So Lugol-Cyidine, just it is nothing but 5% aqueous solution of iodine that is used for very mild, that is straw color will be taking and will be infusing in the endometrium. And even people in our college, we are using this one, Lugol-Cyidine. But still, the Kasimanning always used to scold me, don't use this one. It's interfering with the endometrium. And he has shown a lot of literatures to prove that it is going to affect the endometrium. And then hormones, the main hormone what we are going to use is prostaglandin F2 alpha. It's going to do magic in treating the endometrium. In Indian condition, it's delay. It's all because of delay. In foreign countries, they always prefer hormones at the early stage to avoid this endometritis problem. So the prostaglandin will see that bringing the animal to estrum in 3 days. Okay. So the progestation phase is converted into estrogenic phase. When the animal is in progestation phase, it is in immunosuppressive mode. So organism activity, everything will be there. When the animal enters in the estrogenic phase, it will be having very good uterine defense mechanism. The neutrophils will be entering inside and it will be playing a role in controlling the infection. So just by giving prostaglandin in the animal having a CL and that too having a double dose with the 14 days interval, it will be a good result if you're going to use it in the early stage. But it is also having a lot of problem, like it's going to create other ovarian issues. So several drawbacks are there in the therapeutic protocols. That is developing antibiotic resistance. That's very common nowadays. Whatever antibiotic they're using, the animal is not having effect. When you're going to send the sample for ABS test, it will not show any effect. And we have to go for a new antibiotic every time. That is the biggest problem we are facing in endometritis treatment. Another one, it's not effective in endometrium environment. Certain drugs will be effective in the anaerobic condition. Certain will not be effective in the anaerobic condition, all these things. So nowadays people starting using mixed drug like metronidazole with other antibiotic like that to avoid this problem. And it is not, most of the antibiotics are not effective in the presence of uterine fluid like pus, necrotic tissue, blood, etc. Because of the uterine contains the lochia, the drug may not be effective. That is also there when the fluid is more in the endometrium. And antibiotics sometimes used to inhibit or destroy the leukocytic activity in the bovine uterine secretions. That is also there. The leukocytic activities are destroyed and inhibited by the antibiotic. That also been proved by certain authors. And another one is the residues of the antibiotics used to remain in the detectable level in the milk for a longer period of time after intrauterine infusion, so that the milk should not be used for consumption purposes, etc. So that's also one of the biggest problems, especially in the European countries. And the side effects of the hormone, you know, the prostaglandin is having, so even though it's not having much effect, when you're going to give other drugs like estrogen, etc., it's going to create ovarian diseases like cystic ovary, etc. Once again, it's going to create another drug. So every drug therapeutic protocols nowadays, we are using except prostaglandin, having its own drawbacks. So then we have to plan for some other substances that can be used, that are natural substances that will help in activation of natural defense mechanism in the uterus. That we call it as immunomodulators. Nowadays, people starting the treatment with immunomodulators. So immunomodulators are the new approach in treating the endometritis. They play their role in minimizing the infection by enhancing both systemic and local immunity through proliferation of certain body components like lymphocytes, neutrophils, monocytes, humoral antibiotics, and PML cells. It's nothing but just it is going to enhance systemic and local immunity. That way it is going to take care of the endometrium problem. So different types of immunomodulators have been used, that is endotoxins, lipopolysaccharides of E. coli, that LPS. And nowadays people started using LPS regularly, even in our college, students doing research on LPS. Then use of serum plasma or hyperimmune serum or cholesterol A or PML extract and its components, bacteria-free extract, oyster glycogen, and leukotriene B4 and granulocyte macrophage colony stimulating factor. And now people started going for phytotherapy, that is treating the animal with the herbal extracts like neem oil, etc. They used to use that, we call it ethnoveterinary phytotherapy. So mechanism of action, that's immunomodulator act on chemoattractants of the PML cells through stimulation of interleukin produced by monocytes and macrophages. And PMN and blood monocytes, macrophages are regarded as a professional phagocytes in the cellular defense against pathogenic microorganism. And this is on LPS, E. coli LPS, that's regularly used nowadays. And now people started using this one. And sometimes they are using it along with antibiotics, as prostaglandin also it has been used. And it acts as a chemoattractant to the PML cells and cause influx of serum protein and also immunoglobulin to the uterus. So this is a LPS. And actually, it's available in a 10 milligram pack. And we require only 100 microgram. Just 100 microgram of LPS in 30 ml of PBS, phosphate buffer saline. We have to mix it and then give intrauterine treatment for the animal for just for 1 day during estrus. That is sufficient. So in case of animal, just one dose of LPS around 100 micrograms in 30 ml of PBS when the animal is in estrus. Just one dose. And we have to go for insemination the subsequent estrus. Then it will be getting very good consumption rate. The cost is very less. That's this one comes around 10,000 rupees. That is 10 milligram. We are going to use only 100 micrograms. So the cost of the medicine, what we are going to use for an indigenous animal will be around 100 rupees. But still it is having its own effect. Then people started using serum plasma, hyperimmune serum. this addition of a small amount of serum in the effluent secretions enhances the phagocytic ability of PML significantly, and we can able to see 75% recovery rate from the endometritis and 50% overall consumption rate after administering autologous plasma. That is 50 ml intrauterine at the dose rate of 1:10 of total bacterial load. This was done by Medha in Chennai Veterinary College. And once again, Venugopal has reported that 53% consumption rate in case of endometritis case treated with the intrauterine infusion of this homologous plasma. These are all in the research level, not used in the field condition. The oyster glycogen, a single infusion of 500 mg of oyster glycogen intrauterine increases the uterine neutrophilic influx, clean the bacterial infection, and improve the conception rate. Then ecotrimine B4 is an arachidonic acid metabolite known to be physiologically produced by stimulated granulocytes, macrophages, mast cells, and plays an important role in neutrophil accumulation during inflammation. And 50 ml of this LDB4 at the concentration of 30 millimole osmolars per liter of given intrauterine increases the leukocyte count 5 to 10 times within 24 hours. So that's much increase of leukocyte will be seen in the endometrium. That will take care of the bacteria present in the endometrium. Then granulocyte macrophage colony stimulating factor. It's a genetically engineered one, and it increases the PML in circulation by 12 folds, 12 times increase on PML noticed. And there's a good scope for exploring the use of GMCSF for treatment of uterine infection in cattle in future. In future, it will be having a good effect. Then people started using phytotherapy. Even I have published a lot of work on ethnomedicine, that is use of plants, extract from the plants or vegetable that will be used for treatment of endometritis. People started using this ashwagandha, ginger, turmeric, neem, dulasi, garlic, and the extract of this have been used for treatment of endometritis, and they have shown some good results. Actually, that neem oil is having a lot of report that it is having very good effect in treating this endometritis problem. And thank you. And another thing I want to tell is in India, we are not actually having a voluntary waiting period, VWP. That is not there in Indian condition, but in a European condition for America, people always have that voluntary waiting period for each form. So that period, they just give a rest. Immediately, they go for insemination. So like that, for example, I see in the USA, the form they used to have 70 to 75 days VWP, voluntary waiting period. Like that in Spain, Barcelona, when I was working, we used to give around 50 to 55 days voluntary waiting period. After that, the animal will be inseminated. So we just give only this much of period for postpartum period. Whereas in India, we can see people used to inseminate after 6 months, 7 months. People used to say, if you are going to inseminate animal becoming pregnant, that milk yield will be reduced. This type of things are seen. And during this period, it is going to have all type of problem like uterine infection problem, later cystic ovarian problem, everything is going to appear during this phase, that is postpartum period. When we were working, we start treating the animal around 18th day postpartum. 18th day postpartum or maximum 22 days postpartum, we will be giving a first injection. We never go for identifying the animal in estrus. Directly we go for synchronizing timed insemination protocol. Mostly we follow OvaSync protocol. So first, we always go for pre-sync OvaSync protocol. That is OvaSync protocol, I think everyone will be knowing now. First later, 1994, has developed this one where we can able to inseminate at the fixed time. That we call it as GPG protocol, GnRH, prostaglandin GnRH. And before that, there's also a report from Murare 2000. He has told that when we are going to initiate that OvaSync protocol during early luteal phase, the conception rate will be more. So people started using pre-sync OvaSync. That is, two times we will be pre-synchronizing the animal before going for OvaSync. That is a protocol we are following in European countries, and they're having a very good conception rate.
So for example, around 18 to 22 days, they'll start giving first PG. Then after 14 days, they give a second PG injection. Then after 10th day, they'll start with the GPG protocol, this Oversync protocol. So by around 55 days, the animal will be inseminated. That is a target they'll be having in the farm. All the HF animals will be inseminated around 55 days. They'll inseminate. They never wait whether the animal is coming to eat or not. All this, they never look into it. So that's how they are taking care of the animal. And this two PG injection at 14 days interval, given during this postpartum period, taking care of many problems. That is, endometritis problem is taken care of. And even some uterine problems will be there. That is, when the animal is going to come to eat and it is going to flush out all the things present inside. And even when the animal is going to have a cystic ovarian problem, something developing problem, that will be taken care of with the first GnRH injection. So most of the problem will be sorted out. We are going to take care of this postpartum period. So that is what we are missing in India. And it is very tightly followed in case of other European countries. That's why it's having a very good conception rate in future. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your very nice, informative, and most practical presentation, which is applicable in routine reproductive management of the animal. Sir, there are 2-3 queries I will ask, particularly in retention of placenta cases. Manual removal of placenta is advisable or practicable?
Sir, in India, we are always going for manual removal. The problem is, in the owners are thinking that after removing the placenta, we have to milk that animal, we have to use that milk. So that is the thing. When I was in Europe, when I was in the farm, we never removed even a single animal placenta. Just we leave it as such, it will fall on its own. If it is going to have infection, we just place the bolus inside. That's how. Even I think Andhra Pradesh is there, so Professor Mauli Krishna, sir, he also recommend don't go for removal of placenta. Removal of placenta always end up problem in endometritis. It will be creating an issue. That is, when you are going to remove the placenta by manually, you are also going to harm the endometrium. But our Indian owners never allow us. They always ask us to remove it as early as possible. But most of the places, that just leave it as such. That will be best. Only thing, we have to see that it's not going to get any infection.
It's a true, sir. It's a really one of the important calls, the mental condition of the Indian farmer.
I have seen animals who used to roam with the placenta for 3-4 days in the farm. It will be hanging.
Then another query is there. What is your view about using various intrauterine infusion, which are easily available in the market, and which are more efficient particularly?
Sir, nowadays people started using any broad spectrum antibiotic is sufficient to treat the endometritis. Fourth generation sevoflurane or any drug can be used. Even gentamicin having good effect when you're going to use intrauterine. And now people started using this one, LPS. That's also having very good effect. Even in our college, I got information they are having good conception rate following this one, single in treatment with this one.
Yes, sir.
And better if you are not going to respond, the animal, when it is not going to respond to antibiotic, what you are going to give, just to collect the sample, send it for ABST. Then based on the result of the ABST, go for the treatment. That way we can able to avoid a problem, because most of the antibiotics are having a resistance to this this one. Most of the animals are having resistance to most of the antibiotic because we are not using regularly with 5 days treatment, etc. That's why this problem is there. It's mostly because of antibiotic resistance.
Dr. Ravi Kiran has one query, that is, immediately after conceiving, reduce the milk yield. Generally, farmer complaints. Is this due to nutrition problem or any changes in the thermal?
That's why people are not at all bringing the animal for insemination first 4 to 6 months, because they used to say the milk yield is getting reduced. That is no way connected with the nutrition, but still people are thinking like when the animal becoming pregnant, automatically the blood, it will be taking more nutrition for the fetus, and so milk is coming down like that. But if you see overall performance of the lactation for the throughout the gestation period or the complete lifespan of the animal, if the animal is going to conceive at the earliest, that number of calving will be more, the lactation period will be more, and milk yield will be more.
Another in continuation with the ROP, sir, one question is there. This retention of placenta particular, which is kept, this will not, doesn't cause any much more infection if it is not removed. Dr. Tahir Ghani.
Sir, if the environment is good, that is, if it is the animal is tied in a good environment, there's no problem. Only thing, if the placenta that is hanging out, maybe we can just cut with the scissors, leave it as such. No need to put your hand manually, and some people used to give more force to remove the placenta. That's why it is ending up in trouble. Otherwise, just we can cut that thing that is hanging out and leave it as such. Or if at all you just want, you can just place some intrauterine bolus inside. That is sufficient. I just worked there for some time. I have not seen even a single placenta removed from animal. I have seen like that. But in India, I never seen any animal left out with the placenta. That's the difference.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for your practical oriented presentation. As we know that eating calf ear per it is the utmost important in any lifespan of the animal, particularly dairy animal. And this is very seldom occur in our conditions. And postpartum health of the uterus is most important. And you have elaborately used this, that how it has to be maintained and used particularly, that animal should conceive within 100 days after calving, which is very much important. Sir, on behalf of the committee, organizing committee, on behalf of myself, I am very much thankful for accepting my invitation personally as such within a short period of time and delivering a very useful presentation on this international forum, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for all the organizers who have given an opportunity to share my ideas with my colleagues. And I think it will be a little bit useful for them.
Sure, sir. And it's a pleasure to see you after 2012, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Okay, sir. I'll log out.
Okay. Now on this fourth day of this international online training, we had two speakers and they have very nicely presented. And the third presentation is also very much important in relation to the fertility and how semen and handling of the semen and its storage affect the fertility, particularly the conception rate in the dairy animals. Now, for this presentation, we had a very rich, practically experienced person from the Bharati Agro Industries Foundation, Dr. Jayant Khadse, sir. Presently, he is working as a research director in the Bio World Econ Pune in Maharashtra. Somehow, most of the people might be knowing his name. Some have personally met at different various forums. And sir is going to deliver the lecture on effective storage and handling of bovine frozen semen in animals. And I have requested him also to have give some highlights on the sorted technology in the cows and buffaloes. Now, because I will introduce to this eminent speaker, Dr. Khadse sir has completed his Bachelor of Veterinary Science and Animal Husbandry from Nagpur Veterinary College, Nagpur in 1996. He is alumna of this PGIVS Akola, completed PG in ARGO department in 1999. Then he started his career as a livestock development officer in the Department of Animal Husbandry, Government of Maharashtra. After that, Dr. Khadse sir has joined the very good, well-famous NGO, that is the BIEF, and he has actively participated in the extension promotion programs which were implemented for the livestock development activities for the livelihood of the tribal communities. His major role was in the dandy breed characterization, conservation and improvement projects particularly as such. He has a rich experience of embryo transfer technology in exotic crossbreed. indigenous breed and buffaloes at farm as well as field conditions. His core area of working is in quality frozen semen production of cattle, buffalo and indigenous breeds as well as goat semen as such. And sir is presently actively involved in the research and development of the appropriate technologies for field implementation of the livestock based livelihood program throughout the country. Now, on behalf of the organizing committee, I welcome you, sir, and I request to share your experiences on this topic. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Good evening, everybody. First of all, I am very much thankful to EJIAS, Ashwin Ji, and my colleague for giving me this opportunity as well as Avenue. So, I will share my presentation. Okay, friends, so effective storage and handling of bovine frozen semen. So, majority of us have gone through this, but there are some tips while handling of bovine frozen semen, which will be very effective to getting a very good conception rate. So, just I will start with some background. As you are aware that Indian breeds is the biological focus in cattle breeds and 13 buffalo breeds. Now India ranks first in terms of milk production as well as having the around 300 million cattle and buffalo population. If you see the per capita milk availability was increased from 130 gram to 375 gram from 1952 to 2017 and 18. And in the graph, you can see the milk production and corresponding growth rate, as well as average milk production trend in case of crossbred buffaloes and indigenous cows. So the per capita milk production of the animal has been substantially increased, and all this happened because of the artificial insemination. You can see, even if you see the semen production over a period of last 20 years, so since 2000, from 22 million per straw, it has reached to 120 million straw. And the number of inseminations have increased from 20 million to 78.3 million. And these are the figures from 2019-20. But the overall consumption rate also increased from 20% to 35%. And if you see the overall coverage of AI to the breedable population, you can see the in the below table that it has not been more than 60%. There are only 2-3 states like Haryana, Tamil Nadu, and Kerala. But majority of the states fall below 30%. And if just imagine if all this has been covered through artificial insemination, so maybe the we have huge jump in milk production. So so today's topic is handling of frozen semen. Storage and handling. So before that, I think so it is a complete change from frozen semen. Once because the frozen semen laboratory will take care for freezing of the semen. Now because of minimum standard protocol set by Government of India, we can see a lot of improvement in the quality semen production almost at all the stations. So all the frozen semen stations have to go through a minimum standard protocol for basic operation, and that is the reason actually we find last 2 years there is a quantum jump in quality frozen semen production. At the same time, the Government of India is also putting a lot of effort to National Dairy Plan Phase 1. So under that, you can see that there is a strengthening of the frozen semen station in the country. At the same time, bull production to embryo transfer, as well as Government of India through Nodal Agency NDDB, put a lot of project testing program, project selection program to get a good quality building. So all this come out in a very good quality as far as JLDC is concerned. So we are also improving that. At the same time, recently under NDCLC, World of India imported wholesale JLDC wood. And I think 2-3 months back also, two batches of wholesale season goods are imported. So now, generic point of view, we are actually improving a lot in terms of the in case of generic improvement. But at the same time, quality of the frozen steel is also increased. So, and Government of India also make a norm that purchase the steel from only A or B graded steel. So that part we can say at par. But right from frozen steel lab to the insulation, we have to take care, otherwise there are, so this is a complete change of lab to conception, like artisanal insulation. So that there are two stages, like even validity concern, then like a post-mortality, as well as some other quality tests, validity tests, and even handling, insulation technique, which animal we are insulating, whether the animal is having a proper, if it is weaker, whether that weaker has attained a proper weight, even for the cow, whether the cow is having a very good weakness, infection free, and then the insulation timing. So all these events happen in a sequence, and for every point, we have to take care of the semen, because all the semen is carried from laboratory to the farmer's cow. So we'll see that first frozen semen, because of the heat handling, it leads to thermal radiation, and because of thermal radiation, there are irreversible changes happen in the quality of the semen. So the thumb rule is that frozen semen should be really immersed into liquid nitrogen at all the time for optimal fertility. If you see the factors influencing the frozen semen quality towards storage, that is the effect of atmospheric temperature, wind and solar radiation. So it will have effect on the storage capacity, so there will be more air pressure. Height to which the canister is lifted, duration of exposure of higher temperature, like where you are doing the insulation, quantity of cement dosage packed inside the goblet. Like a goblet capacity is having 700 and you can put 750. So care should be taken that sufficient nitrogen should be available around each and every straw, so that it will not affect the temperature variation. Similarly, quantity of cement dosage packed inside the goblet, packaging of the cement dosage, because there are now, as per the government norms, majority of the cement is frozen in cement mixed only. Cement mixed is almost not in use. But according to package draw, we have to do the packaging. Similarly, the level of liquid nitrogen inside the cargo container at the same time, interval between subsequent leaks of the same character. So these are all the factors which actually affect the changes in the exposure of the cement to the variable temperature. And if we avoid this, so it will again improve the quality of the frozen cement stored in the container. So everybody knows about liquid nitrogen is mainly used for keeping or storing the cement. So it is colorless, odorless, non-toxic, non-inflammable nasal gas. So actually it is a boon for our rest of industry that we can carry our high-derived inputs, very inputs at the farmer's doorstep. And in liquid form, it is almost 7 times smaller than the gaseous form, so that it is easy for storage and transportation of the gas. The refrigerant boiling point is -195.8°C, and the temperature is around -200°C. like just I will go through the different types of cryo containers. So there are two types of cryo containers mainly used, like one for transport application, so where the neck size is smaller as compared to the biological. So TA and DA type container, and depending on the use and use in the field or for the storage, we'll get the varying capacity of different cryo containers available in the market. Here you can see, so this is a 550 liters capacity, 320 liters capacity. Again, is the wide mode open container generally used for during cryo preservation. Similarly, if you see this TA-55, so this is for transportation of liquid nitrogen. This is Jumbo 12. So both these have 50 liters capacity. But you can see here there are around 11 canisters. So you can keep semen in this, and it has a wide mouth. So it is easy for placing the semen as well as taking out from the container. So these are different types of containers, 1.2 liter. This is 1.5 liter container, and this is again 3 liter container. So maybe these two smaller trial cans used in the field program, and this bulk storage is used for storing the cement mainly at cement discharge or cement bank location. And in field classically, this transport is used for transporting the nitrogen, and this there is one more DA 43 liter, which is used to store the cement at field location. And again, these are having the different storage capacity. Like DFD has a 6 canister, so we can keep around 1,000 to 1,200 straws. Similarly, this is the biggest one, we can keep around 3.5 to 4 lakh bottles. And in Jumbo, we can have in one layer around 12,000 straws. If you see the cryo container makeup, you can see it is a double layer vessel. So inner chamber is insulated, and inner chamber is the intact one. And inside that, there is a space for storage of the nitrogen. Similarly, why it is a joint layer? Because then there will not be a heat dissipation, and you will find the uniform temperature throughout the storage time. The outer jacket is made of aluminum alloy, so that it will be lighter in weight. At the same time,
sir, hello.
Hello.
हाँ सर, थोड़ा सा पुढे येऊन बोला, आवाज थोड़ा सा तुमचा लो येतोय थोड़ा सा. बस म्हणजे हाँ बस जवळ थोड़ा सा घेऊन. हाँ ओके ओके सर, फाइन ओके.
सो आउटर जॉकेट इज मेड ऑफ एल्युमिनियम अलॉय, सो इट इज लाइट इन वेट, एट द सेम टाइम वेरी स्ट्रॉंग टू टेक केयर व्हाइल यूज इन द फील्ड प्रोग्राम. सिमिलरली इनर वेसल इज कनेक्टेड टू द आउटर जॉकेट ओनली एट द नेक, सो दिस जॉइंट इज मेड ऑफ सफिशिएंटली स्ट्रॉंग इपॉक्सीग्लास फाइबर, which is very much heat resistant here essentially. So because of that, while handling the container, we have to take utmost care so that it will not be broken. So this is a cut section of the cryo can, and you can find here the inner space, you can find the slot. So there are 6 slot. So this is a 3 liter container. So there are 6 slots. So depending on the, like Jumbo, there are 11 slots. And you can find the in between insulating material here, as well as this is the cap. And so you have to always keep the container upright position so that there will not be spillage from this. At the same time, I think we will take this in the subsequent slide. So you can see there is a temperature variation. So this is the liquid nitrogen level. So there you will have minus 220 degrees Fahrenheit. So almost it is -196°C, and at full flying you will get around -100°C. So if you have an invariable nitrogen level during the storage also, so then there is also change in the temperature of the stored cement. And you can see the while lifting also, you have to take care that the canister level are lifted up to the stove line only. So for this keeping of all the dry cans, preferably it should be kept on wooden plank, or nowadays there are some rubber rings also there, so which are fitted on the bottom of the cryo container to avoid the germs and contact of the hard surface. Keep always in upright position, avoid direct exposure to sunlight. Similarly, for every operation while taking out the cement, you just have to take care that the lid should be immediately closed. The lid should not be open for more time. Similarly, lid should not be interchanged. And this happens mainly in the field. You find that the lid is interchanged because of while transporting and other operations. And many times, then the for some containers, because of use, overuse, the lead size or the lead shape is distorted. So there is a space, and again it will lead to the more evaporation of the liquid nitrogen. Do not stack one dry container above the other. Rough handling between pieces to one another should be avoided, because it may lead to the leak fracture. Similarly, during transportation, cryo containers are to be protected in the crate. Similarly, they should not be stored in the waste bin. Charging should be done slowly. And charging means when you have a cryo can without nitrogen, initially you put little bit nitrogen and allow it to settle, and then only you can charge the container slowly. During filling, avoid sewage overflow of the liquid nitrogen. Vent wall should not be tampered. Regular cleaning and sterilization of the equipment should be done. So even for cryo cans also, even for Jammu also, cleaning and sterilization is very important. Whenever you bring this container from outside, you just clean with the sterilizing solution. And because it will avoid and it will take care from the bio. So these are some pictorial. Keep the container handled with the care. Don't roll it on the ground. So for this, you can use the trolley. Keep the container from falling and then you can carry from one container to another. At the same time, do not put on one another. Don't change the. Similarly, do not weld or brain because it is one piece, and don't keep horizontal. So, as I have told, the cold chain is to be maintained at the production frenzy at the same time at field level. Then the liquid nitrogen level of each cryo can should be measured with the periodical interval, and we should always ensure that the cement is submerged in liquid nitrogen. So for that, depending on the use of the cryo can, the frequency of opening and closing, taking out the cement, we can fix the refilling. So maybe alternate day, or depending on the use, we can have one daily also, we can put the nitrogen in the storage container at a cement bank or dispatch system. Then quality of the frozen during storage should be checked at periodic intervals. Because like for bulk storage, you can find here, there are many big cryo tanks. And depending on the breed, we have separated it out. So what we are doing actually for every month, we are taking out randomly one or two straw from different levels. It will be done by independently by the quality control people. So they will take out the straw and check the postmortem utility. And depending on that, we are ensuring that the protocol given to the cement bag or dispatch people they are following, and the cement kept in the container is having the same utility as during the production. Similarly, very important thing is regarding the inventory management. Because now, depending on the breed, like we have cattle breed, buffalo breed, if you see at Bayer, we are almost 34 altogether different breeds from which we are taking the cement. So almost for each breed, we have a big trial camp. Maybe for buffalo, we have more. And we are following that that first in, first out system. So accordingly, what we have done for each big trial camp, we have made a numbering for different canisters. Like in one canister, we have different goblets. So we have named it 1, 2, 3, 4 as well as 3 location. And accordingly, we have fully computerized system. So on one click, we can know the location of the goblet backside where we have placed the cement. Since last 3 years, we are following this system. And it is actually very helpful even for dispatch also, because there is no need to take the cement actual from the container. So depending on online, we can take the order, and depending on that, we can just find out the container at what level that cement is stored. And accordingly, we can make a packing list, and these people, they can just take out the cement and pack the smaller container and dispatch. So this is also very important for handling. So if the handling from bulk storage to the field center, if we have minimal handling of the cement, then there are better chances. Otherwise, what happens many times, the cement container from bulk storage goes to regional level, then district level, again then testing level, and then goes to the center level. So there are 4 or 5 times handling. So what actually we are doing in my program, directly from laboratory it goes to the that particular state, and from that state depot, all the cement is supplied with nitrogen every month to all the centers. And so there is only 2 times handling, one in the bulk storage and another is at the state depot. And the third time, the AIT gets the cement directly into its container. So these are different types of goblets for packing the cement. So for bulk storage, we can use this big one. There we can keep 7 stock. This is only for 10. This is again for 70 stock. This is for 200 stock. So depending on the use. So what we are doing is actually from main station, we are supplying the cement bulk packing of 700. And from the state depot, they are actually packing as per the demand, like 50 doses or 200 doses for each center. So for each center, we actually ask for the requirement for every month. And all this cement is packed in the state depot. And so there is a goblet transfer directly from that state depot container to the AIT container. So again, it will help in minimizing the handling, at the same time exposure to the sunlight and other. These are different types of containers. Now, as per the government minimum standard protocol, we have different colors. Breed-wise, different colors are fixed. We can see different colors. Then, while transferred, actually, one cylinder leaves the draw with the hand. Even this is also not good because the temperature is different to the make of the cryogen. So here the temperature is almost at the room temperature, maybe 30-35 degrees, and the humidity is -196. So there is a big jump in the rising temperature of this drop. So it should be done this way. The chemistry should be lifted up to the neck of the up to the neck, that is near the source line, and then with the pre-cooled process, the straw should be taken from the cryogen. And for filter, so this is only for taking on one or two straw, but for cattle breeding center, goblet to goblet transfer is always advisable. So this is not benign. So handling of frozen semen at a field, just what I have told you, like directly it goes to the regular zonal level. So sufficient stock should be maintained for a period of 2 to 3 months. So what we are doing actually, depending on the requirement breed-wise, so we actually call for 1 year quarterly, and accordingly we supply to the state depot, and from that depot it goes to the each cattle breeding center. Then at each breeding center we need a VA 35 liter container for human storage, then T55 for supply of liquid nitrogen, 3 liter container to carry out frozen semen dosage in the field. So you can see how the cryocan is fitted on the motor cycle. So the container fitted in the steam carrier lined by the soft form or rubber while carrying on the motorcycle. Containers are not exposed to bumps or dirt. Similarly, the heavy object should not fall over them. They should not be dumped heavy on the ground or heavy object. Not to be tilted in such a way so as to cause pressure on the neck of the container. Always shield them from rain, from wind, as well as sunlight. If you find few drops of ice gathering on the outer surface of the neck of the container, then suspect for the damage. Then their care should be taken that immediately transfer the cement doses to a good container and always ensure that the motility of the cement is more than 50%. Similarly, in case of accident, if the container falls on the ground or there is a suspect, then also keep that container in an isolated location, then ensure that the motility, after ensuring the motility of that cement, therein only that cement should be used. And while accident also, you can keep that container immediately in upright position and filled with the liquid nitrogen as quickly as possible, and then go for the polymerization. Then we'll see the steps. Everybody is aware about this, but majority of the time you will find that use of thermometer while thawing is missing, and it is also contributing to the less consistent rate. So vertical thawing should be done, and there should be a thermometer. So ensure that the temperature is 37 degrees Celsius. Take out the straw with the pre-cooled process, put in the water, then wipe it with the tissue paper. Then you just load the straw in the gun, then cut at right angle, and then put a tip over the gun. Then before that, the animal should be properly displayed. Then clean the backside of the towel and slowly insert the gun. Just I have the position of the gun, because the gun should be guided, should not be forcefully put inside the uterus of the cow. You can see the direction of the gun slowly then we can make it through the service and put the thing to be put this here. We can just take out here and put this even of the body of the user. So I think yesterday Dr. Mohanty also has shown this, like effect of handling of frozen cement. So these are very important things, but many times we overlook them, and it will result that getting 70%, we from 72 we go to 17. Like just I will read again because this is very important. Prolonged exposure and re-immersion of the cement into liquid nitrogen. Careless handling of cement, warm hand, tongs, guns, incorrect high temperature. Sometimes in field, there are some people, they have very good unique experiences that they have learned something very unique for frying. They keep the straw in the pocket and they got a cow pregnant. But these are exceptional cases. It cannot become a rule. So always follow the procedure defined. Then contamination of dust, gun, water, alkali, faulty gun loading. Even for alkali, sometimes the people they use the soap for as a lubricant. And many times the soap water actually dribbles down and pour out the gun. And sometimes it may come in the contact with the cement. And you will find that despite of all the efforts done, you will not get the confidence. Faulty gun loading, cutting of the seal. So for gun loading, actually, once you load the gun, just ensure that the piston is easily, you can pull the piston and just stick at the tip of the tip that the cement top you can see there. Then incorrect cement placement, speed in placement, just to want to be done in the hurry. Hygiene and cow equipment as well as cow handling. So this is also very much being observed that the cow is not properly restrained. And many times, what I found in field also, many people, they are not actually examining the cow before incubation. So first, golden rule is that first, ask the history of the farmer, examine that cow, whether the proper heat is there, cold, different tone is there, then wash the backside of the cow. And so by that time, you get total idea, as well as you can do the back racking also. Then after just cleaning and washing on the backside here, so there will not be any dirt. And then you can pour the cement and then put the gun and insert the cement in the interest of the cow. So be careful. Almost, I have shown you the chain in the beginning. So if you have not followed all these procedures, you will find that if the chain is break at any location, so you will not go from very good quality, high density merit, cement to your consistent, and at the end, farmer is also not happy and you will also not. So this is just in brief about handling and frozen cement. So just yesterday, you know, Dr. Mohanty has given a very good lecture on sorted cement technology, right? So genesis, different approaches, different agencies that are known as sorted cement. At the same time, what we are doing in the country right now at different research institutes like NDRI, NIAID, and other locations, even some businesses are actually involved in production of sorted cement. This is very much required because you are seeing the country's total electric population at the same time coverage of air. So, and for sorted technology, the main constraint or you can say limitation is the cost. Everybody talk about that. But you see, I think for different types of people, it is really going to be useful. And now, as per the new government policy, at the same time, because of industrialization as well as atomization in agriculture, the use of bullet power is also going day by day decreasing. So, this is a very important technology. And at Bite, actually, in 1970, we have imported 6 sorted cement from texting technology. The main purpose is actually to test the technology at farmer level, at a very small and marginal farmer level, how it works and what are the results. So in 17 we have done the pilot with the help of almost 70,000 users. And that for Hosse and Jersey cement, we got around 47% consumption rate and fit ratio of more than 90%. Then in 2018, actually, we have established state cement production facility at our Unitan Cinder Rotary. So here we have started in 2018. So almost we are producing the cement from Bir, Saiwal, Tharparkar, Rathi, Rekhi, as well as Buffalo Bridge, Mura and Jafarwadi, and Hussein, Jersey and Jericho. So just I will tell you about the results, what we got for the sorted cement produced in the country. As a bias, we have a very good breeding network across the 12 states of the country. And it covers around 5,000 cattle breeding centers. And every year, we are doing around 50 lakh inseminations. And through this network, actually, we have used the sorted cement of different breeds. So you can see this is the number and this is the consumption rate, this is the number of inseminations in that particular field, and this is the consumption rate we observed. So you can see right from 35.8 to 49.2. So this is the range of consumption rate we observed in various breeds. In case of Mura, we got around 42.6% consumption rate. And almost all these cement used through our network at a very small and marginal farmer level. There are few big farmers also, but they are not taking directly by themselves. But on their own, they are using cement. And I can quote some very good examples like Bhagirathi Dairy. In Nipal, they got around 65% consumption rate. At the same time, in South, they got around 35 to 40% consumption. And now, since last almost 2 years, they are using only texting for breeding. Initially, they also have some reservation of using texting cement in the south. But while using this cement for during piloting also, initially our focus was also in deeper. But slowly we have introduced this cement in first charity and second charity cow. And what we observed that in the cow in a good condition with a good body score, then in first, second, even third charity also we get very good consistent rate. So you can see this all is not in heifers, so it is across heifers to third charity animals. Similarly, if you see the female sex ratio, you can see here is the number of the total calving. So out of total 384 calving, we get 93% female calving in case of Jafarwadi, Mura. Only in case of Jersey 75, it is showing 84% consistent rate, and Tharparkar, it is average 88%. So almost if you go by average, it is more than 90%, it is almost 93.something. Female calf born, and as we started in 2018, and now it is taking are increasing the number of products being used in the field also, and this sex ratio will also improve because if you recollect Dr. Morty's yesterday talk about the probability, like he gave a very good example of the tossing of the coin and getting 8 out of 10. So the chances of first 10 are less, but if the number goes on more and more, then it actually stabilizes. If you have more than 1000 installations, you will find the probability is more than 90%. And at the same time, for the cement, during the production, utmost care is taken for taking the X and Y bearings form. So we are keeping always more than 90% X bearings form in the road. Another very important thing I would like to tell that now, because there is always improvement in the technology, and almost as compared to the conventional cement, the production of solid cement is almost as good as the conventional cement production. Initially it was less, but now it is almost 5 to 10% less only. But it depends again on the breed. If the breed and the bull performance is very good, maybe for some particular bull, the production of the solid cement is much more than the conventional cement. So this is just about different breeds and bull dams, milky grains from which we are producing the specimen. So what we have done actually, top bulls available at our stud, we are using for production of the sex product. You can see some pedigree of these are bulls born out of the embryo transfer. This is a HF 70% bull. His bull density is more than 9,000, and this is a farmer bull. So this is actually the first lactation bull, 9,000. Then another bull in holiday. Then these are indigenous breed bull like Vijay, Vishnu. Then all these bull sections are procured from a very good Gaushala from Gujarat. Then Karim and Kumba, so these are Sahiwal bulls, this is the category. Murad bull. So, if you want more information, you can just go to our website like bias.sire@bias.org.in. So, you can get all the details of bulls and sausage chicken and getting information. For more information, you can write to our email as well. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your elaborative and pinpoint presentation regarding the handling of the and storage of the frozen semen, maintain its optimum fertilizing ability. There are certain queries, sir. What should be the level of LA2 in containers, and does the rule of 15 centimeter from the top apply to all containers irrespective of their capacity?
It's actually varying. So depending on the, if you go to the manufacturing guidelines, so depending on that, you can go and follow those guidelines. So even you have to take the static evaporation rate, what is static evaporation rate. Then another thing is that how we are handling the container.
Okay, sir. Are the goblets made by company as per the number of straws stored?
Goblets made?
That means the goblets made, manufactured, depending upon the number of straw, or it's vary. What is the criteria for the?
Actually, the goblets are made up as per the size of the canister. Like if we have honeycomb type, so we can keep like 7 goblets. So we can keep 7 straws. just I am talking about jumbo container. So in jumbo we can keep 700 extra, but in the same character we can have, because what happens actually, if we have a small goblet used, then at bulk storage you require more space for storage. And because of that, almost you are spending double cost for storage. So if at a dispatch level or maybe at the field depot level, then we can pack in a smaller goblet. So goblet actually, they are made as per the size, like 10 mm goblet, 30 mm goblet, 35 mm goblet. So accordingly, then we have to put this problem in that.
Yeah, is there any availability of digital indicator for LN2 level checking in containers?
Yes, yes. There are indicators now a day for all the frozen cryo cans, so that not only indicator for level, but if it is connected with the silo, like a big cryo storage, liquid nitrogen storage, automatically it will refill also.
Okay. Pocket so size.
There is no need to take care of the refilling also.
Okay. Pocket size alcohol thermometers for use of AI works in field. Where the availability is there, sir?
Thermometer is the best actually.
Yes, sir. All these, they are the compliments from the participant. So, okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you on behalf of the organizing committee. I am very much thankful with your busy schedule. You have accepted our invitation and made the presentation on this international forum, and very practical oriented presentation in terms of the handling of the semen, frozen semen straws in during the field level in the LN2 container. It is one of the aspect which has to be taken into consideration during the that means for the fertility improvement programs as such. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Ingram. Thank you.